Welcome to Hard Talk. I'm Stephen Sacker. Russia's invasion of Ukraine and Kyiv's defiant response will have a long-term impact on geopolitics far beyond Europe's eastern flank. The West insists Putin must fail. But this century's rising power, China, offers Mr. Putin friendship without limits. Could the Ukraine invasion foreshadow an effort by Beijing to eliminate the thorn in its side, namely Taiwan? Well, my guest is Taipei representative to the EU, Mingyan Tsai. Could what starts in Ukraine end in Taiwan? Mingyan Tsai in Brussels, welcome to Hard Talk.
It's my pleasure to be here with you.
It's a pleasure to have you on the show. You, of course, sit there in Brussels. You are the representative of Taipei, as it's put, to the European Union. I just wonder, from your position, what impact has Russia's invasion of Ukraine had on your homeland?
Yes, I think our global community is watching the situation in Ukraine closely, and we believe that the impact of the Ukraine situation will be far-reaching and global-reaching. So I think the first situation that we need to keep watching will be about the geopolitical phase in Europe may turn out with a new map. So this is a wake-up call to our global community, because it shows that how easily authoritarian countries can use force to challenge the rule-based order and international borders. So it's very important for our democratic community to hold the line and then to raise the cost for Russia's invasion. Otherwise, some other authoritarian countries around the world, such as China, may copy that kind of model and then to do the same thing to its neighborhood, if this is the case.
Let me stop you there. You do feel, do you, that there something has happened with that invasion of Ukraine, which has repercussions in your region, and in particular, you see it, do you, as some sort of values trial where the rule of law, international law, and democracy are somehow at stake in a much broader sense?
Yes, that's correct. Because I think this time, Russia used its military muscle to challenge the international border. And in our region, China is also, have very strong intention to challenge the rule-based order. So what we concern is that China may copy that kind of model and follow Russia's steps to do the same thing to the neighborhood. And in the past few years, actually, China has intensify its military activity in the vicinity of Taiwan. And, China keeps sending its military aircraft to intrude into the air defense identification zone of Taiwan, ADIZ, by showing its military muscle to its neighbors.
We'll get to the military situation on the ground and in the Taiwan Straits in just a moment. But just to stick with your notion of this being about international rules, the international order, the implication of what you're saying is that there is some direct parallel between Russia and Ukraine and then China and Taiwan. But of course, there is one fundamental difference, isn't there? The international community recognizes and has long recognized the sovereignty of Ukraine as an independent nation state. The international community does not recognize Taiwan's status as an independent nation state. Indeed, the vast majority of countries around the world adhere to the one China policy and the notion that your status is far short in Taiwan of being an independent nation.
Yes, I think maybe you are right. But more and more countries around the world, they are started to look at Taiwan from the perspective of one China policy, as you just mentioned. But actually, one China policy have some differences compared to China's proposal for one China principle, because one China policy recognized that People's Republic is the only legal government in China, but does not recognize that Taiwan is part of the People's Republic. So we hope we can continue to use that kind of policy stance to deepen Taiwan's partnership and the substantive cooperation with our like-minded friends around the world.
If you think the international order and international rules are at stake, how disappointed were you that when it came to that crucial early vote at the United Nations demanding a withdrawal of Russian forces from all Ukrainian territory, some of the biggest, most influential countries in the world chose to abstain? And I'm thinking not just of China itself, but also of India, of Pakistan, of South Africa. If you in Taiwan want to convince yourselves that the international community does respect rules and does value democracy, maybe that vote was a bit of a disappointment.
Yes, I understand your concerns, but I think what we are now witnessing is a kind of competition between two different groups. One is democracy, the other is autocracy. So I think after Russia's invasion of Ukraine, the competition between these two groups of countries may reach a new high in the future. And what do we concerned is that Russia and China has announced they are going to deepen their strategic partnership with each other. And as you mentioned earlier, that they say their partnership will have no boundaries, will have no limits. So that is thing that we witness in, on the side of the autocracy. And so, on the other side...
Right, so if that concerns you, and you see the strength and depth of the friendship between Russia and China, do you believe that what has happened in the last month and a half has made more likely a Chinese military intervention in your homeland, in Taiwan?
Yes, actually, we stay on very high alert on China's military activity around Taiwan. And in the first day of Russia's invasion, China sent about 10 sorties of military aircraft to intrude into Taiwan's ADIZ. So we will continue to watch the situation. And what do we concerned is that China is showing its military muscle to Taiwan, and the purpose is to use military intimidation against the Taiwan's people and Taiwan's government to say that China has never abandoned military option against the Taiwan. And also China is using its military patrol in the Taiwan Strait to get used to the battlefield in the Taiwan Strait.
Yeah, so every time... I hear what you're saying, and there is no doubt if one looks at the number of sorties flown by the Chinese Air Force over Taiwan's airspace, if one looks at the naval activity in the Taiwan Straits, there is something going on. And one can also say, I guess, that the focus of international attention is very much on Ukraine right now, which Beijing may well be aware of. One US congressman put it like this just the other day, Mike Gallagher, a Republican. He said, all of this evidence suggests that we are right now in the window of maximum danger for Taiwan. Is that the way you see it?
Yes, I think, this time we need to hold a spirit of solidarity and unity to support Ukraine and then to raise the cost for Russia's invasion. And I believe that China is watching the situation closely because, there will be two major concerns from the Chinese side. Number one is that how likely Russia can conquer Ukraine without too much price. Number two is that what would be the economic impact of global sanction against Russia? If Russia can, conquer Ukraine and achieve its political and military objective without paying too much price, then China may, follow the steps. And if Russia has to pay a lot for the invasion, then China have to think twice, because this year is a very important political year for China. Communist Party is going to organize its 20th National Congress, in which Xi Jinping is going to extend his tenure for another 5 years, maybe for the entire rest of his life. So I believe that Xi Jinping would be very cautious to do the calculation before waging a war in the theater of the Taiwan Strait against Taiwan.
Well, Xi Jinping might well be cautious if he believes that Taiwan can put up as fierce and effective resistance to the might of the Chinese military as Ukraine has already put up in the face of the might of the Russian military. So the question to you, if I may say so, as a representative of your country, is Do you believe, honestly, that Taiwan is in a position right now to match Ukraine and put up that level of effective military resistance?
Yes, I think, we have been investing so many resources to improve our defense capacity, and Taiwan does not want to enter into kind of arms race with China, which is not in Taiwan's interest, because China is much bigger than Taiwan in terms of military resources and manpower. So what we want to do is to improve our defense capacity, particularly focus on the promotion of Taiwan's capacity to do the asymmetric warfare against the Taiwan, China's potential invasion against the Taiwan. And that focus go to the modernization of Taiwan's submarine force, missile force, air defense system, and our C4 ISR facility. So we'll continue to build Taiwan into a strong and agile military forces so as to push China think twice before going too far.
One aspect of Ukraine's resistance which has been very striking is the degree of coherence in their society from leadership. President Zelensky very effectively leading his nation, to the degree to which all Ukrainians have united in their defiance and their common cause against Russia. Do you think there is the same level of unity and the same quality of leadership in Taiwan?
Yes, I think when we talk about the situation in Taiwan, one thing I want to share with you is that Taiwan is a democracy. We don't want to become part of authoritarian China, particularly after Hong Kong situation. No one in Taiwan has any interest in China's proposal for one country, two system. So if China decides to move toward military adventurism in the Taiwan Strait, Taiwan would definitely take any kind of efforts to safeguard our democracy and our sovereignty.
This time
we are watching about those endeavor taken by Ukraine people and the government. That is how to build a very resilient civilian society against the foreign invasion. And that issue become a very hot issue at Taiwan at this moment. That is how to build a very strong system for mobilize our reserve forces, and also to promote the connection between our civilian society and our defense department. So that become a very important issue in the policy debate in Taiwan at this point.
That's very interesting. How worried are you by the leverage that nuclear weapons gives China, just as we can see, in a certain sense, the leverage it has given Vladimir Putin? Because when NATO has shied away from any talk of imposing a no-fly zone or indeed sending jet fighters to the Ukrainian military, they have cited the danger of escalating with Russia, i.e. with a nuclear power which appears to be ready at some point to use nuclear weapons as part of its battlefield strategy. The very same could be said of China, and that gives China a leverage which may come back to haunt Taiwan.
Yes, I think there might be many military options in the hands of Chinese leader, but what Taiwan can do is to prepare for all those worst scenarios in our best way.
How can you prepare for a scenario in which you don't have nukes and China does, and the whole world knows that?
Because I think when we talk about to deter a war, we can mobilize all kind of policy resources and tools. I personally would like to share with you a very good idea proposed by our American colleagues, which idea is called as integrated deterrence, which means that we democratic countries, we can take some collective efforts together and then to make use of all kinds of policy resources or policy instrument to hold the ground and then to raise the cost for those countries or those revisions power that intends to challenge the rule-based order and international borders. If we can do so, then we will be able to push China to think twice before going too far. So that's the logic of deterrence.
Right. We've talked about different aspects of the military strategizing. Let's now talk about economics and leverage. Again, what we have seen in Russia is the West pretty united in imposing sanctions, but there have been limits because of the reliance of Europe in particular on Russian gas. the difficulties are even greater when it comes to assessing leverage in any future potential conflict involving China and Taiwan, because China is so interwoven into the world economy, so powerful in the world economy, particularly in Europe. You sit as the representative of Taipei in the European Union. You know just how reliant Germany, for example, is on trade with China to the tune of some 200 billion euros a year. You know that China's Belt and Road Initiative now reaches into Hungary, Italy, Greece, a host of European Union member states. China has effectively ensured that the world can't afford to isolate China.
Yes, I think, compared to Russia, China is a much bigger economic power in the international arena. And we may also need to look at this issue from a different angle. That is, Taiwan is also a powerhouse to semiconductors and ICT products. If we just look at those advanced chips, Taiwan accounts for about 92% of the global production. So-called advanced chips means, you know, which is under the 10 nanometer, you know, advanced chips.
I know very well from a little bit of research that the Taiwanese dominance of the semiconductor chip market is extraordinary. You have the power, whether it be from Apple iPhones to all of the computerization of automobiles, you have the power to shut down vast swathes of electronic industry across the world. Are you telling me you are now prepared to use that sort of power to become, if you like, a semiconductor superpower in the world?
I'm saying that if China invades Taiwan, there will cause a lot of problems with the shortage of Taiwan supplies of those semiconductors or ICT products, in which China would suffer badly. So what I'm talking about, Taiwan also have some leverage in our hand. And the most important thing is that we need to, as I mentioned earlier, we need to show that kind of solidarity between our like-minded friends of the democratic society to let those potential invaders to understand the cost would be very high if they go too far.
Yeah, well, some Taiwanese have even gone so far as to talk of a Silicon Shield that protects Taiwan in reality from Chinese aggression. Do you really believe that?
Yes, I think after the Russian invasion of Ukraine, it would be very important for our global community, particularly our democratic society, to think about how to reshape supply chain security for many items, such as energy, food, semiconductor, or some other key industry sectors. Without doing so, I'm afraid the question that you mentioned earlier, if we just depend on China's market, that may increase China's leverage and may make China become more confident to use its force to achieve its political objective in the future.
I'm fascinated by what you're saying and the quiet way in which you're projecting Taiwanese power. But let's be real. And again, let's look at Brussels, where you sit. One country in the European Union, Lithuania, has gone much further than their EU fellow members, and they've actually allowed Taiwan to open an office under the label of Taiwan in their country, a sort of embassy of Taiwan. China has been infuriated by that, and as a result, has cut trade ties with Lithuania, has tried to isolate Lithuania, and Lithuania is paying a price, and indeed is so upset that it's trying to counteract China's measures at the WTO. But surely the message of that spat between giant China and tiny Lithuania is that many Europeans are going to think very hard before they confront China in that way.
Yes, we understand your concerns, and Lithuania is a very brave country that always withstand that kind of suppression or pressure from foreign hostile states. And this time, Lithuania decided to deepen cooperation with Taiwan and immediately suffer economic coercion from the Taiwanese side. But because this time China went further to impose secondary sanctions against Lithuania, which is to push European countries or European companies not to use the component or spare parts from Lithuania, otherwise they cannot sell their products to China. This kind of action not only do damage to Lithuania's economic situation, but also jeopardize EU's important principle of single market integration. And like the reason, maybe, you know, in the process of suffering, you know, economic coercion from China, Lithuania also received very strong political support from the European Commission and the European Council. And like the reason you just mentioned, EU would like to submit the Ukraine, Lithuania case to WTO for further consultation in support of, you know, Lithuania. So what I'm saying is that we will continue to deepen our cooperation with European Commission because Taiwan has been isolated from international community. So we treasure that kind of cooperation program between Taiwan and European Commission. European Union has been a very important normative power in the world. So we use our cooperation with European Union to reach out to many important issues that we share common concerns.
Right. Well, that's your job as the diplomatic representative of Taipei to the EU. That is your job. But you also come with a lot of experience in the National Security Council, in think tanks, in national security back in Taiwan. So I'm going to tap that experience to ask you a bigger picture question about your most important relationship, and that is with the United States. Are you concerned that Joe Biden, well, to put it bluntly, is a little bit confused about how far he's prepared to go in defense of Taiwan? Because last year he made some statements about defending Taiwan and then had to backtrack. Confusion doesn't help you, does it?
Actually, I mean, United States and Taiwan are long-term friends and partners in the Indo-Pacific region. And in past 5+ years, United States has announced, if I remember it correctly, about 15 package of arms deals to Taiwan in support of Taiwan's defense modernization.
No, I know that. You certainly are getting weapons, but I'm just coming to this point about Biden, what he said last year when he said, anyone taking action, invading against our NATO allies, we would respond. And then he went on to say, it's the same with Japan, it's the same with South Korea, it's the same with Taiwan. And then people reminded him that actually it wasn't quite the same with Taiwan, and the US has a policy of quote-unquote strategic ambiguity rather than a full-fledged defense pact, and Biden's White House had to backtrack. And I'm just wondering whether that confusion worries you.
Not really. What we sense in Taiwan is that U.S. commitment to Taiwan security is becoming clearer than ever. And like the reason, at the very beginning of Russia's invasion of Ukraine, United States immediately sent naval vessels to patrol in the waters of Taiwan Strait and also sent a very high-ranking delegation led by former the chief commander of general staff to reconfirm U.S. security commitment to Taiwan's security, the stability in the Taiwan Strait.
Right.
So we appreciate that kind of clear commitment issued by U.S. government.
Last question. You said that this year is sensitive for Xi Jinping. You don't think that he would launch a military operation in Taiwan this year. Let's look ahead for the next 5 years and let's try to learn the lessons of Russia-Ukraine. Do you think within the next 5 years that your homeland, Taiwan, will face a major military attack from China?
Yes, that is one thing we always stay on very high alert. And that's the reason why I mentioned a little bit earlier in our conversation, saying that we would prepare for the worst scenario in the best way, the smartest way possible to deal with all kinds of scenarios that may turn out in the theater of the Taiwan Strait. And the number one thing that we would like to do is to consolidate domestic consensus on this issue.
But your message to your domestic population is that war is coming, is it?
Yes, we need to prepare for the worst. We cannot predict when or how it will happen. But what we can do is to prepare for the worst scenario in the best way possible. And that is a kind of a political communication between the government and our ordinary people, and also a kind of communication between Taiwan and our international community, particularly our friend from our democratic society.
All right. Well, Ming Yen Tsai, I thank you very much indeed for joining me from Brussels. Thank you.
Thank you.